Well, hello there, you multi mega super ones. Ralphie here with Whisky Review 210. And this is our special guest malt today. Yes, not a blend, single malt. But before I start to review and peruse this and share my tasting notes with you, I have to say something about the malt mention, of course, because I've got to credit these malt mentions with those who provide them. And that malt mention was provided by myself. For this time, for the simple reason it's a malt mention for someone. That someone is Simon. Simon, hello there, my friend. We've never met, but I think you know my vlogs quite well. Now, there are many Simons in England, which narrows it down a little bit. Let's narrow it down further. Let's go to Liverpool. Yes, we're in windy Liverpool and frequently wet Liverpool, but never lacking in character is Liverpool, and neither is that cosy little flat that is accessed through a black gate. Yes, Simon, we're narrowing things down rather rapidly, and the chances are that you're sitting watching this blog, sipping away at a small brewch laddie, and hopefully you'll be enjoying every minute. You're about to enjoy this very minute a little bit more, because unbeknown to you, the delightful Eleanor, who thinks very highly of you, has suggested to me that I suggest to you, Simon, that perhaps you didn't check the washing machine on Sunday quite as thoroughly as you should have. And if you're looking for that lovely citrusy, butterscotchy, much anticipated malt moment, you might do better than to go through and check the washing machine right now. Or alternatively, if you're rather busy with this Ralphie vlog, you can wait till it's finished. But you know who you are, and I think you already suspect what this is about. Congratulations, my friend. Enjoy your discovery. Back to the review. Bladnoch. For those of you who have been following these Ralphie vlogs, you may recognise that this whisky has been following us on a recent journey through the Malt Whisky Masterclass. Oh yes, Whisky Review 209, Parts 1 to Part 7. Quite an extensive and the most detailed and eccentric articulate whisky masterclass ever to appear on the internet. Here to be helpful, hope I'm helping. Let's help myself now. Oh, well, I've already done so. I was about to pour myself another whiskey. I've already done so. And I mustn't be greedy. Heaven forbid that I drink too much and end up drunk in one of these reviews. Doesn't bear thinking about when I'm busy preaching the moderate drinking, responsible drinking message. One more minute. Oh, dear, oh, dear. For those sharp-eyed malt mates who have noticed that at least 2 weeks ago, in fact, longer than 2 weeks, I poured a glass of whiskey and put a lid on it and left it sitting up there on the bookcase. There was a reason for that. Oh, yes. That whiskey is from this bottle. Put it there. Water has been added. Yes. This bottle, incidentally, an independent bottling of Bladnoch, 19-year-old, single malt whiskey, matured in a refill bourbon cask by the looks of it. Bottle number 66 of 194 bottles, bottled at 54.5%. That's some strength after 19 years. The Angels, by the way, did not get much of a share of this. The Angels do not get much of a share of many casks of whiskey, depending on the quality of their storage. Never assume that there is an automatic loss of 2% alcohol per year in barrels of whiskey. It varies considerably. The reason I'm reviewing this particular bottle is I'm making a point here. Is that when you go out and you buy, for example, a bottle of 12-year-old Highland Park, you're becoming acquainted with a flavour profile which has been specifically created by the distillers at Highland Park Distillery, using a selection of sherry casks, bourbon casks, perhaps Madeira casks. They are blending together different single malts to create a recognisable profile of a single malt that you get to know. However, if you then go out and buy a single cask version of Highland Park, it's important that you do not expect the same experience as you get from the standard bottling. And this applies for every whiskey, every single malt in particular. What we have here is not the standard Bladnoch. In fact, at this moment in time, because it's such a craft-orientated distillery, there really isn't a particular Bladnoch standard brand flavour. What I can tell you is that you're looking at something citrus, relatively light, but full-flavoured, oranges and lemons, some biscuity notes, honey, yeastiness, and some more citrus. That is Bladnoch. Now, I've poured a glass, I've added some water. I am now ready to share my tasting notes in this one. Whatever independent bottle, the independent bottlers, whatever bottle you buy from them, when you clock the name of the single malt on the label, whether it be Bladnoch or Macallan or Glenfarclas, if that appears, and it usually appears in its other form, Ballindalloch or whatever, whether it be Highland Park, whether it be Talisker, whether it be even, my goodness, you never know, someday it could even be a Lagavulin. Do appreciate that you'll need to be patient with yourself in getting to know that whiskey, because it is not quite possibly not recognisable of a whiskey that you're used to or expecting. People say that independent bottlings can be a bit of a gamble, and to a certain extent that's true, because individual standards of casks do vary. However, I can confirm that if you get a good quality bottle, independent bottling, and all you need to do is check online, ask around, phone a friend, do whatever it takes, so that when you splash your cash and you get a good bottle, once you get to know it, and it may take half the bottle to get to know it, it may take sharing with pals and getting the feedback from other whiskey drinkers for you to get your bearings and get to know the whiskey. So you don't have a situation where you just taste the whiskey once you've opened the cork and go, oh, I don't recognise that. Oh, this isn't what I was expecting. That can be a very good thing, because it challenges your growing prejudice about what a single malt should be. This particular single malt is from one cask. In my opinion, not a bad colour, but it's a refilled bourbon cask. Because for 19 years, the whiskey's been in that cask, and I'm getting certain raw spiritiness coming through. This, you know, if it had been a fresh bourbon cask, after 19 years, the cask could well have overwhelmed the spirit, but that isn't the case here. And so we're getting clues in the nose, clues on the label. Colour, as if that matters, amber -2 plus honey stroke almond. Nose, an intense, yeah, even with water, it's a real nippy, bitter, citrus rind, lemon rindy nose, with fudge and honey, wax, candle wax, pineapple, touch of pineapple there, hint of banana and toffee. There's a grapefruit rind, a bitter oak on the nose, and a dryish white fruit note, slightly reminiscent of some of the drier aged Rieslings. Taste. I do enjoy this bit. Yep, I'll do. Intense bittersweet lemon rind. Not an easy malt to get to know. Got to be patient with this one. Fudge, yeastiness, and a real biscuit note. Rich tea biscuits if you're in Britain. Dry, with addition of water, it's a dryness, a bitter sour arrival, green ginger, tannins, and more of that bitter oak. The oak is withheld from overwhelming the spirit, but it still strongly asserts itself in that bitter oak and the tannins. A certain creamy vanilla in the development, and into the finish, you get a long lemon oak bitter finish with hints of biscuit and a yeastiness, not unpleasant, but distinctive, a yeastiness that is never that far away. My conclusion is a demanding but a rewarding malt, no compromises here, but it lacks a certain full dimension. A good but not a great whisky. 19 years old, going on 14 years old. So the refill cask has kind of left this for the age slightly underaged. And over the time, it becomes more lemon bitter. Now, what I would do here is I would keep a sample of whiskies. Now, here is a sample of a bottle of young Bladnoch, right? And what I'm going to do is, knowing that this single cask Bladnoch has got that specific influence of oak from what it was matured in. It hasn't been blended with anything, with any other single malts, to kind of give more of a presentation. I'm going to give it my own little additional presentation. And oh, excellent. I'm going to add just a wee drop of young Bladnoch, which I have kept aside from a previous bottling. And I recommend you do this with this experiment with many of your independent bottle purchases at cask strength, is if you can get hold of some of the official bottling and just add a wee drop, whether it be Macallan, Talisker, whether it be Glenelgin, whether it be Auchentoshan. It really is a fantastic learning experience. My marks for this one, 86, yeah, out of 100. There we have it. Excellent stuff. And I conclude by saying, be aware of any preconceived ideas that you may be developing towards whisky. We all, as we gain experience, start to apply certain values based on an experience. Get to know where you're coming from, because sooner or later you're going to have to examine a certain amount of personal prejudice, although you may have good reason for it. Now, for myself, my prejudice, and it is really, is towards your small independent distillers. Now, the reason for that is that I believe that they don't get such a voice online, and because I'm not taking free stuff and not accepting the trips and the hospitality of the corporate multinationals, and will continue not to do so, I think that I'm in a stronger position to talk about and represent the small independent distillers who can't have the budget, who can't afford to buy attention online. But importantly, as well as representing a whole range of whiskies, I do increasingly want to concentrate on small independent distillers, the little guys that produce such tremendous range of whisky, who I believe, because of their inevitable commitment to Scotland, the fact that they proportionally employ more staff than the big corporate multinationals per litre of alcohol produced, because they pay all their taxes in Scotland, unlike corporate multinationals who can be located outside of Scotland, because there are less corporate shenanigans which can occur with your corporate multinationals. And I recommend you just have a look at corporatewatch.org for the reference. But I am aware that some of the big companies, the big powerful corporate multinationals who are involved in Scotch whisky, can be perceived as being intimidating and bullying by other operators within the whisky industry. And it's perhaps a social consciousness, a heightened sociability, would not go amiss in these big companies. There we are. Just an opinion. I pick my words very carefully, and what I give you here is simply an opinion. But that is the reason why I'm continue to be happy to talk lots about your little distillers. They may not be so widely available wherever you are around the world, but if you are aware of them, then you will know so much more about them when you see them. This glass, I'm going to have a sip. I recommend you do this. Both the same whisky, but one was poured 2 weeks ago. Has it survived just sitting in a glass with a lid on it for 2 weeks? Yes, it has. Chocolatey, caramel, fudge. The citrus has completely gone away. It's as if I'd poured a different dram. Try it, guys. Try it. Pour a glass of whiskey and leave it on the shelf with a lid on it for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and then pour a fresh glass and taste them side by side. It's all part of the malt education. Thank you for watching. Hope you've learned a bit. Hope I haven't waffled on too much in my usual eccentric way. But if you want to know more, Ralphie.com or YouTube Ralphie Stuff. That's my home channel where all the archives are, and you can search up all the videos that I've been producing over the last couple of years. Nice talking to you. See you soon. Bye-bye.